So hello all, and the screen right now in front of you is the gist of our 5-year-old company, which is the OikoEssence Edutours LLP, and these are the environment educational activities we are carried since 15-17 years. But these all photographs are from the when we started our venture, me and Gauri, who is going to present her presentation today. So we started this venture, and these all are the activities conducted by us. It may be schools, it may be in the schools, maybe the city schools, maybe the urban rural schools. It might be a safari camps or the camps which are there in a very rare areas, very remote places, and maybe some archaeological sites, anything. So basically, we are using nature camps as a tool for the environment education. So let's begin for the today's series. This webinar series, Spectrum of Conservation. We started this series around a month back on Zoom, and today we are presenting the last session on Zoom. The last session of our webinar series, Spectrum of Conservation. Actually, during this series, we try to explain science or complicated things into a very simple manner. And through various subjects, it might be aquatic ecology, starting from aquatic ecology, maybe grasses, introduction to the insects, to the some rare flowers like Cirrhopegia, how they are conserved, some of the beautiful flowers like rhododendron, which are the species of rhododendrons. Or it might be a window gardening workshop. That means a window gardening webinar series, that how you can plant some of the day-to-day useful plants in your own window garden. And today we are going to talk about the biodiversity around us in the cities. So today we are going to talk about the urban biodiversity, and Gauri will be presenting this session. If you want to introduce Gauri, actually she is a very fabulous girl, very good friend of mine. By profession, she is a naturalist, an avid traveler, blogger, and photographer also. She is MSc in botany, and she has done her postgraduate diploma in sustainable management of natural resources. Of course, she is a designated partner of OikoEssence Edutours, but previously she has worked with BNHS, that is Mumbai Natural History Society, and WWF, Worldwide Fund for Nature India. She has participated in many biodiversity documentation as well as conservation projects. Her 30 plus publications are there, which includes research papers and popular articles. She has also contributed in a book known as Trees of Shivaji Park, which enumerate the plants around the Shivaji Park. That is again green beauties of the city areas. So over to Gauri now for this particular session. And after her presentation, we have Mr. Ruchir Bansal with us, who will explain us, who will give us an example how successfully they have protected or trying to protect and plant plants in their own areas, in their own neighborhood areas. So about Ruchir, I will introduce him later, but right now to Gauri.
Or maybe Shreya, you can just introduce him now and then again. A little bit at least.
Yeah. Actually, Ruchir, he is a resident of Churchgate area, specifically Maharshi Karve Road, which it's a completely heart of the city, you can say. And where the green cover is more or less cut down or, never planted again. So he is a resident of that area. By profession, he is a chartered accountant. And he runs a practice of software development company. But in the heart, he is an avid nature lover. and he is a part of many campaigns for save trees, to save trees. Also, he is quite successful in his project, that is plant and protect trees in the neighborhood, in his own area, in the Churchgate area, with active tree loving citizens and local municipal corporator and tree officers. This is much more important. With the help of government official, he is successful in plant and protecting the trees in his neighborhood. So about Ruchir, we will come to you just 20 or 25 minutes later. But right now, to Gauri, for the whatever the beauties, urban green beauties in our cities.
Yes, thank you so much, Shreya, for introducing us so well. Let's start with the presentation for today. Yes, urban biodiversity. This is, as Shreya mentioned, this is going to be our last session of the series. And I'll switch off my video because that might save some data. Now, when we say about urban biodiversity, when we talk about urban area, generally what comes in our mind is, all sorts of buildings, offices, and residential areas, or probably some undeveloped section of the city that might include slums or some other unauthorized constructions. But somewhere there, we always forget about the major part of the city, that is the biodiversity. It is present everywhere. Let it be city or let it be a village, wherever you go, biodiversity will be there. So don't even think if you're staying in the city, then sorry, there is no biodiversity. No, it is not the case. You are surrounded by biodiversity wherever you go. So now, why is it not changing?
Put it on the slideshow mode.
I think I'll have to do that.
Yeah.
Can you see the next slide now, Shreya?
Yes.
Yes. This is our city. This is Mumbai. Today, we are not going to talk about the very complex scientific names. Let it be a very friendly, a session. All our sessions were, of course, friendly, but today I'll use less scientific terms. I won't go into that. Let's enjoy what our city has. This is Shivaji Park aerial view. As Shreya mentioned, we have also contributed in writing of trees of Shivaji Park book. So that time we have taken this. So city is not only about the buildings. It is also about the greenery, the green patches that we have. This is the most beautiful view I have ever seen. Shivaji Park. I've been to so many times to Shivaji Park, but I have never thought it will look so beautiful from top. So that's something that I wanted to share with you all. You can see the ceiling over here, Bandra on the other side. Yeah. So on this note, we'll start the slideshow. What do you mean by urban area? Urban area is basically that includes city, even the suburban areas, or areas that adjoins the two mega cities. There are many people living in between, if there are suburbs continued, then you can call all the stretch as the urban area. And urban biodiversity is something that includes the variety and variability of the all living forms that exist in that particular city or that particular area. Okay. And these urban life forms might change from place to place, because if you are staying somewhere in the southern part of the country, so you may not see the same birds, or you may not see the same plants that you come across that you might come across in the city like Delhi, which is situated in the northern part of our country. So it varies, but it everywhere. Now about the plants, if you go to see, majority of them might be exotic plants. Okay, exotic is something that is not Indian. The origin is not Indian. It's called as exotic. And all these plants, birds, even the insects, they have to tackle with the urban situations, something that we all do. Okay, so even they have to adapt to the urban lifestyle, what we have. Main example, if you go to see in terms of birds, when you say Mumbai mein kya dikhta hai, so of course people will say Mumbai mein kawa dikhta hai, kawe ke alawa kuch nahi dikhta hai. But it is not the case. Of course, crows are the major occupy major portion of our because the great work, they are the scavengers. Okay, so they are doing the great work for us as helping in keeping our city clean. Okay, even you can see parakeets, they try to utilize all those. And there are many more birds who are doing like this. Now, where will you find this diversity? But of course, in gardens, even in your windows, even at some places that are not so far under constructions or they are still neglected, you will see tremendous biodiversity in especially in such areas, because there's nobody to take care, nobody is going to put pesticides over there. So you will see a lot of insects, you will see a lot of birds, you will see a lot of shrubs growing in such areas. So these are the good places to observe such diversity. When you talk about what is there in the diversity, let's begin with the smallest plant that we have. This is, everybody knows, now it is a rainy season, so of course you are going to face algae almost everywhere. Then you have bryophytes, you have pteridophytes. Okay, these are ferns, or simple form is these are ferns. And bryophytes, the example would be the moss. Some people even be aware about the moss sticks that sometimes you get in the market. So that is nothing but the bryophyte that you are using. Yes. When you ask people about what trees you know, so even if you are staying in the city, people will say ki mujhe mango pata hai, mujhe jackfruit pata hai. Okay. So yes, of course, we do have mangoes and jackfruits in the city as well. Now, Mangifera indica, okay, everybody knows IUCN red list, red data list. If you check the status of Mangifera indica over there, I'm talking about the original Indian plant, I'm not talking about the Alfonso's. Mangifera indica, that plant, it will indicate as data deficient. We don't have data. How many trees are at least, if this is of least concern, or this is rare, or this is endangered, we don't have. IUCN doesn't have that data, so that is something that I wanted to indicate. If there are some young students or even researchers who are doing a great work in identifying such plants, and if we are doing the research on the number of species, then please check about this Mangifera indica, because this is like very common plant, and it is not good to have such very common plant as data deficient in the IUCN red list. Then of course jackfruit, everybody knows. Then we'll come about some flowering plants. We do have a lot of flowering plants in the city. I'll just explain very few of them. This is frangipani or champa, chafa, white chafa, safed chafa. There are a lot of name to it. Even it is called as pagoda tree, even the temple tree. Okay. The origin is of course not Indian, although it is called as temple tree in India, but it is not Indian. English name for this is a frangipani. Now this has a very interesting history to it. Frangipani was the scent treader. in olden times, like in Britishers' time, when they were ruling at that times. He was the scent trader who used to sell the scent of this particular flower to the royal British ladies. And nobody knew from where it comes, you know. And when the Britishers started conquering the land, they came across this particular plant. And since they didn't have any other name for this plant, so they frangipani, the scent trader's name, to this plant. And that's how this tree became the frangipani tree. Yeah, that is something interesting. And this is a very tall tree that is planted all along the roadsides. You might have seen these fruits over here. I hope you can see them. And these are very famous fruits because they are very stony. If it hits you, it's like it hits very bad and it falls from the top. And they are very common roadside trees. This is called as wild almond or jangli badam in Marathi. And then, of course, there is parijat, there is tagar, a lot of plants that you can you generally plant in the pots or even in your society that contributes to the biodiversity of the city. Yes, of course, then we all are very familiar about these three trees. This is Peltophorum or the Son Mohar. Everybody knows Gul Mohar. Gul Mohar is very famous. Some people also refer it as flame of the forest, but if you talk in Indian context, this is not the flame of the forest because this is not the original Indian tree. So you might not see this tree in our forested area. So we do have flame of the forest, but we'll talk about it later. This is for us, this is Gulmohar. Gul is red, mohar is flower. So red color ka flower hai, iske liye ho gaya Gulmohar. Now this tree looks like Gulmohar but doesn't have red flowers but has yellow flowers. The flower like gold. No, so that becomes the Son Mohar. Sone jaisa flower hai, toh Son Mohar ho gaya iska naam. Then we have a major portion of our city. You will come across this particular tree, that is the rain tree. This and I have shown a picture of bat. Now what do they have relation? Basically, rain trees, of course, they are very famous or infamous because of their canopy. Infamous because in monsoon season, major trees that fall down are rain trees, even sometimes Gulmohar and Sonmohar as well. But rain trees are, you get a lot of reports of rain tree fallen down during the summer, during the rainy season. Anyway, but the pods or the fruits of this particular tree, they are devoured by bats. Okay. And there was one study done by my friend for his MSc project, and it has shown that those seeds that are fallen from the fecal matter of the bats, they germinate faster than the regular seeds. So it has some relation, and it is not only applicable to rain tree. There are many other trees, even some flowers like this, like a sausage tree flower. These are pollinated by bats. So bats are pollinators as well. Okay, so that is something a very important role that bat plays in our ecosystem. And even staying in the city, they are still doing their job. Okay, so whenever you see a plant, they are not alone. There are pollinators on the plant. There are a lot of scavengers on the plant, lot of them. So tree is itself is an ecosystem. Now some other plants like bhend or the Indian almond. Sorry, I think by mistake I have mentioned Indian almond earlier. That is jangli badam. This is Indian almond. That is deshi badam. This is a very common tree that is planted in our garden, which is generally referred as Ashoka. Whereas if you see scientifically or if you want to have more correct name for this, this would be the Asopalav tree. The leaves are drooping and it feels that this, they are crying. So that's why Aso is derived from Asu, that is the tear, and Palav is leaves. So Rone wale patte ka ped, that's why it became Asopalav. Whereas the original Ashok tree, as the name suggests, no Ashok, that is no grief or no shok, जो हमेशा हंसता रहता है प्लांट, जो हमेशा खुश रहता है, दैट इज अशोक. एंड यू कैन सी द फ्लावर्स ओवर हियर. इट्स अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल ट्री. इट इज प्रेजेंट, इफ यू वांट टू सी, इट इज प्रेजेंट इन आर इवन इन जिजा माता उद्यान, दैट इज द बायकला जू. मेजोरिटी ऑफ दिस प्लांट्स यू विल फाइंड ओवर देयर, एंड स्पेशली अशोका. इट इट फ्लावर्स प्रोफ्यूजली ओवर देयर. इट्स जस्ट वंडरफुल. इफ यू हैवंट सीन इट, then please go and have a look after, probably after the monsoon is over, maybe somewhere in I think December or January, you will come across these flowers. Now there is one small butterfly here. This lays eggs on the leaves of Asopalo. So when I say trees are not alone, I mean this. No, they lay their eggs on the leaf of this tree, and you will find caterpillars of this particular tailed jay butterfly feeding on the on these young tender leaves. So that is some relation that they have. So since the number of this tree is more, you might see lot of tailed jays in more numbers in our city. Now let's talk about some highly indigenous trees of our area, or rather the Indian subcontinent. These are the fig trees. I haven't come across a single fig tree that doesn't support any biodiversity. All of them support a tremendous biodiversity. This in the left hand side corner down, this is the these are the fruits of umber or audumber. I have deliberately put it over there because there is a very, I don't know who does that, but a lot of forwards they come claiming that this is the flower of umber tree, or some beautiful flowers, white color, red color. Yes, I don't know from where they come, but they come and then people keep on sending us, is this true? Is this true? Is this the flower of audumber? Then no, sorry, none of them are the flowers of audumber. They look like this. This is the, what you say, a group of flowers. I'll explain it to you later, because if you cut it, you will see all these small flowers inside. Okay. So this entire ball is a group of flowers. And there is one particular relationship that we will talk about later. You will see one leaf over here. Okay. This is a Krishna bud. Or Makhan Katori. This, if you want to see, you can go again in Baikala Zoo. You will come across this tree over there, where a real lion cage used to be there. Just next to that cage, you will come across this this plant. It's literally looks like a katori or a bowl, one single leaf. And you can see some paper wasps have made their nest over here. So again, trees are not alone. So let's talk about the flowers of any fig tree, including audumber. If you take a section of this of the fruit, or if you just cut it open, you'll come across these tiny filament like looking things. This is a single flower. Okay. There is a wasp, a small wasp, an insect that enters through this end of that group of flowers. It is called as Hypanthrodium, but let's not go into this. This fig wasp, it enters into this group of flowers. Okay, it lays its egg inside. Right, then the wasp comes out, but the eggs they are still there. They grow up inside, and once they become like proper insect, they come out. And they fly, and this circle keeps on continuing. Okay, so these are the flowers of fig wasps, and this is the these are the flowers of figs, and this is the relationship with the fig wasp. So here you can immediately say that no figs, no fig wasp, and no fig wasp, no figs. So this is how the relationship happens. Of course, these fruits are devoured by birds like coppersmith barbet. In Marathi, we call it as tambat. And even these are devoured by the Indian grey hornbill. Both of them are present in our city. Rather, this barbet, the coppersmith barbet, is also named as the, is also known as the bird of Bombay. Okay, so yes, all these two we do have in the city. We have some, in our orchards, we do have mangoes. Sometimes we have bear, okay, that is Zizibus. We have jamun, papayas, and if you all love to devote them, you all should thank such lovely insects who are doing their job. They all of them, they are honeybees, stingless bees. They are, all of them are, all these trees are pollinated by such insect members like honeybees, stingless bees. Especially stingless bees do the pollination of mango. So we all should be thankful to them. Now, of course, weaver ant, why have I kept it over here? Now, if you go to any mango orchard, you will...
Sorry to interrupt, Gauri.
Yeah.
Yeah, but can we be a little bit faster?
Yes, yes, yes. So you will come across this weaver ant's nest colony almost everywhere, and they really give you a nasty bite. Yes, of course, we have... this is the flame of the forest. That is Palash, which is original flame of the forest of our country. Yeah, and you will find birds like sunbirds feeding over them because they give a lot of nectar. So you will find a lot of birds when once the Palash is flowering. Then of course Amaltas, the Taman or the Queen's flower, or this is the state flower of Maharashtra. They all will attract a lot of insects. Of course, when the tree is dead, don't even think that kuch nahi hai ispe. Yes, there are still many scavengers, like even you will find termites or other bugs on that dead tree. Even some beautiful fungus, you will find them growing over there. So the tree still supports a lot of diversity even after its death. Then of course these are some beautiful butterflies that we have in the city. There is striped tiger, there is sailor, there is denied egg fly crow. Lot of them in the city. If you have a single plant of rui somewhere in your area or in your society premises, you will find butterflies that, like tiger species, coming and laying their eggs over there. So it's a very good plant to observe for caterpillars of tiger butterflies. Then of course we do have these all lovely insects. Let me tell you that all of them are clicked within the city. So there is not a single picture that is in this particular slide that has taken from outside. They are all our Mumbaikars like us. Of course there are spiders. They are not insects, but it's another group of spiders that thrives in the city. Again, this is all taken within the city. I hope you are able to see this crab spider that mimics a particular flower. It is actually waiting for its prey to come for the nectar, that is the prey's insect. And once it reaches near the flower, this fellow will grab him and try to eat him. This is the tent spider. You might see them even next to your society if you have a green patch. Then of course, we have frogs, toads, many reptiles. I haven't kept any photograph of snakes, but we do have a lot of snakes in the city as well. So yes, we have them. Even the birds, common examples would be bulbul, mynas, parakeets, pigeons. Even these two are the Asian coil. This is female, that is male. All of them, they are very much adapted to the city life, same as the other birds like kingfisher, water hen, even the magpie, beaters, and there are many more. Actually, I have selected very few, but all of them, they are present in our city, clicked in our city. Then, of course, we do have flamingos that come every year. to visit our city. I hope they keep on coming even the next year and for many years as well. Of course, even they are trying to adapt, but of course their their habitat is getting lesser and lesser due to the over increasing size of our city. When we talk about mammals, squirrel, langur, some macaques or mongoose, these are the common mammals you will see, and these are present almost in every part of the city except for of our country, except for these two macaques. If you are staying in the northern side of our country, then you will see rhesus macaques. If it is a southern part of India, then you will see bonnet macaques, probably even in some urban areas. When we talk about Mumbai city, this also includes the diversity that is present in Sanjay Gandhi National Park, which is very much present within the city city limit, a part of it, and part of it is in Thane. But this city also is a home for 1,000 species of plants only in Sanjay Gandhi National Park. I'm not even talking about the plants that are present in the gardens. So yes, our city has tremendous diversity, but that doesn't mean that chalo sab jagah city banaye, because city has its own impact on the surrounding environment. Urbanization does have impact. That is the air pollution, water pollution, land pollution. You name a pollution and that the source you will find in the city. You know, even the fragmentation. This is something called as a fragmentation. If there was a continuous patch of the forest, and if there is a small city develops over here, then this patch gets cut. Okay. Or this is how the fragmentation starts. If the city keeps on developing, this entire patch will become two different patch of forest, whereas in reality there were one. So that is something about the fragmentation of the forest, and that happens due to the cities as well. Yes, of course, global temperature, global climate, like temperature is rising. So we are all contributing to the global warming, as well as we are putting pressure on the surrounding areas from where our water comes, from where our paper comes, from where our furniture comes. Staying in the city, we do have impact in all those areas. So that's what I all wanted to say about the diversity of these urban biodiversity. Of course, we should not forget leopard, because this is very much adapted to the urban areas. Because it is a very adaptive animal. Rather than tiger, you will certainly not see a tiger near the city. Of course, earlier his home range were. It was even found in Mumbai city, but since the city has grown, since the population of human have increased, the tiger has lost its habitat, and this is the case in Mumbai. Whereas if you go to see this beautiful bird, it is also losing its habitat due to various reasons. Urbanization is one, industrialization is another, a lot of reasons. So even these two have faced a major challenge in thriving near the city area, whereas these two have managed so far. And yeah, that's it about my presentation, Shreya. Over to you.
Okay, thank you, Gauri, for such a nice presentation, because we have lot of things in our city, but we never try to locate them or understand, know more about them. Now we have another presentation with Mr. Ruchir Bansal. As I introduced him, he is a CA by profession, but still he is an avid nature lover by heart. And he will today talk about his successful example of the plant and protect trees in the neighborhood area. As I mentioned earlier, he lives in a resident of the Churchgate area, which is a completely urbanized area, but still how they manage to protect trees in the areas. So, Ruchir.
Hi, everybody. Hello. This is Ruchir.
Yes.
I'm going to share a slide.
Please continue.
Yeah. Are you able to view this?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and you're able to hear me as well?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay. Well, thank you, Gauri, for your presentation. It reminded me of our walks in the national park. And where I am right now in Churchgate, it is raining quite heavily. So it's really the time when you would see much of this biodiversity that you've taken us through. It was a lovely presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
So this segment now will focus on a civic collaboration for improving greenery in one's surroundings. So I'm a resident close to Churchgate. I live on the Maharshi Karve Road. And over the last 10 years, I have been given the opportunity to engage with a number of campaigns to save trees. It all started when the trees on our road were supposed to get cut, and we were plunged into this campaign willy-nilly. Since then, I decided I'll help out with any neighborhood initiative or any initiative to save trees across the city, having gone through it myself once. And over the years, we've met with substantial success in some initiatives of saving trees and limited success in some others. But what I have seen is that, you know, over these years, you come across people in the city, citizens, who are genuinely fond of trees and will act to save trees. Many of us are fond of trees. There's a wise saying that says, I took a walk in the woods and came out taller than the trees. It reflects the upbeat feeling that one gets, the upbeat zeal that one experiences having gone into the woods and lived amongst the trees. In fact, Gauri's presentation brought about some of that happiness and joy to all of us. So we wanted to save our trees, and I've come across people across the city over these 10 years who are genuinely interested in saving trees and will act to save those trees. And I've also come upon officers from the BMC who sincerely undertake the task of keeping the trees in your own localities, in my locality. So 3 years ago, in 2017, we started a small group. We made a team of people living locals around Churchgate, and some people I had met over the years who were passionate about trees, and officers from the BMC. And since I got to know them relatively well, they all agreed to come onto a common WhatsApp forum. And for the last 3 years, since 2017 till date, that team has brought about some wonderful changes in our neighborhood. So today, I wanted to share with you some of the experiences of saving trees by working as a team, by participating in campaigns, and how to prevent felling of trees where it is unnecessary. The idea is to leave behind with you a set of techniques and some resources that might help any individual who is keen to do this, who is keen to improve the greenery in their locality, to be able to do that successfully. So, okay, we'll start with the first slide here. In 2017, this is the team, our neighbors. We are at a local garden here. This was the start of our first meeting and a group tree walk down the Maharshi Karve Road. So this group of us includes, this is Harshita. I don't know if you can see my cursor. Can you see my cursor?
Yes, yes, we can.
Okay, so this is our corporator, and these are our tree officers, and the rest of us are citizens from the road. All of us decided that we would walk down the Maharshi Karve Road from one end to the other and examine the trees that stood on the road and see what their requirements were, if anything needed attention. And over these years, a bond of trust, like I told you, the bond of trust that had formed through the Save Trees campaigns earlier, that resulted in the formation of this group that had facilitated the coming together of the officers as well as the citizens. So what we did was we went from one end of the road to the other and took an Excel file and mapped out the location of each of these trees and mapped out the species of that tree. And in callouts like this yellow callout over here, we mapped out what were the needs of that tree. Some trees needed looking after. Typically, what we found was one could identify vacant tree beds. Where an earlier tree had fallen, there was a vacant bed on the road. In this game of increasing green cover in your localities, land is of the essence. So where you can find a vacant tree bed, it is the easiest to request the BMC to come and plant a new tree and increase tree cover. We also found, you know, there were maintenance issues that could be resolved with the BMC's help. For example, cables on trees, fresh soil was to be added in some tree beds, were to be repaired, and so forth. A number of other issues were also addressed through these tree walks. A tree walk was kept simple. We would spend, you know, maybe two tree walks in a year. Each tree walk lasted about 2 hours. We would designate the time up front, and we would try to cover the stretch of road in those 2 hours. And our corporator often joined us in these tree walks. The tree officers were always present, and citizens, as and when they chose to, they participated in them. So another benefit that came out from these tree walks were, because we formed a team, that team could help in saving some of the splendid trees on our road. This is a banyan. Some may recognize it. It is a banyan that stands in front of the Eros Theater at Churchgate Station. So the metro had built a station in the Oval Maidan, which is somewhere on this side. And because they wanted to do some work along the roadside, they wanted to divert traffic into a way that would have this tree to be cut. So because we were a team, we went to different offices. This is our corporator, Harshita. These are the citizens of our group. We went to the metro office. We went to the police office. And we represented a case where the traffic could be diverted in a way that the tree could be left alone. So this tree, this beautiful tree, this is our tree officer, Mr. Shetty of the AWOD. He's been a hero in all of this work. This tree got spared along with a number of other such beautiful trees. The other thing that we were able to do was we were able to keep an eye as a group of citizens in this area on excessive trimming. Trimming needs to take place each year of trees, you know, especially before the monsoons, but it needs to be adequate, not excessive. And as a group, all the members were informed that whenever there is a trimming and you have a concern that there is excess trimming, you need to go down and ensure two things. One is that they have a permission which is written, which will specify the tree, the diameter, the circumference of the branch that is to be cut. And the second thing is that a BMC tree officer must be present. So because of this, we were able to check a number of instances, not all of them, but a number of instances of excessive trimming. Because the tree officer would then speak to the contractors who were on the road and who were trimming these trees to stop excessive trimming. This is a photograph from 2019. Now, one of the best benefits that came along from this partnership over the last 3 years was that the locals got a flavor of gardening, which is a rarity in Mumbai. Most of our roads are congested. We hardly have an opportunity to do any gardening. But because we did these tree walks, we were able to identify vacant tree beds. And then the locals could be invited to actually work with the garden department officers. So here, these are the garden department officers. These are the gardeners who are from the local garden in our area. And these are the citizens. And they all came together and they would, you know, help water the plants. Initially, when the new sapling was dug in, they would water the plants, they would prepare the soil, they would prepare the pit, they would dig out the mud and so forth. And it was a most enjoyable session, and one that permanently would change this area, permanently, or at least for the lifespan of the tree, would change this neighborhood. The BMC, this is another picture from 2019's sapling plantations along these roads. The BMC also played a very proactive role in this entire initiative. So to begin with, we were provided small saplings, but the BMC soon realized that the survival chances of a large sapling, they take root much more easily, the roots go deeper easily. So the survival chances of a large sapling are far higher. So over time, the BMC started providing us some very tall saplings. Some of these saplings were over 15 feet tall. And this is a shot of all the gardeners standing with pink Tabebuya saplings, which are behind them, which we were planting along this roadside and this neighborhood. The second thing is, with a larger sapling, the greenery spreads more rapidly. With a small sapling, it takes a lot of years for it to, you know, come into any significant amount of green. So both of these advantages we were very grateful to the BMC for. In 2018, this is a photograph from 2018, not only did the BMC give us the saplings free of cost, but they actually took us to the zoo, which is one of their main nurseries, the Jijamata Udyan, to allow us to select saplings of our own choice. So here the citizens had gathered, and you know, this was our tree officer at the time, Mr. Tushar Shinde, and he's looking at, you know, he's allowing us to choose the saplings we wanted on the road, which is a beautiful opportunity for each resident to shape the greenery in their own locality. The photographs that were taken after those sapling plantations were now in 2019, they started becoming geotagged. So what would happen is the tree officer would take a photograph with a geotag that showed the map, the area where the photograph was being clicked. It showed the address, it showed the time and the date on which it was taken. It even showed the weather conditions, which is behind this, and the temperature, which prevailed at the time the sapling was planted. All of these geotagged details were then submitted back to the BMC's office, where they would be collated and would be sent to the central government, to the Maharashtra government. So if I was to summarize it, over the last 3 years, this partnership of citizens and the government officers and the corporator has yielded some wonderful results. In 2018, we planted about 10 saplings of our choice. In 2019, there were another 25 saplings that were planted, not only in our area, but the neighboring roads had all joined in by then. So, you know, a number of neighboring roads were also selected and neighboring localities were selected. So to give you an example, we planted one tree on the Marine Lines Ayakar Bhavan Road. We planted another one next to KC College. We planted more than one, actually, next to KC College and next to Marine Drive. Then we planted some along Oval, some along Cooperage. We planted some along the Cathedral Church, and we also planted some along Cuff Parade. So the area had grown quite substantially by then. In this year, because of the COVID scare, the plantations are all carried out during the 3 months of monsoon, really. So because the roots then naturally, the plants naturally take root at that time. This year, the BMC has gone ahead, initiated the plantations, and we are trying to work out how social distancing could be observed while these plantations are done. But two saplings have already been planted this year. Over the years, I've never seen the BMC quite so responsive as they've become now. On Twitter, BMC handles are available, and one can actually go onto this. And here in 2019, I had complained of a tree in a different area that had fallen over Twitter. And the moment I reported it, the next day, very next day, a team of the BMC officers came and planted a sapling close to it. And they posted a before and after photograph on Twitter to let us know the sapling had been planted. So it is a really good time for all of us, fortunately, where the government seems to be quite receptive to ideas of tree plantation. This was not always the case. In 2012, there was a huge banyan tree that stood in front of my building. And over the years, that banyan tree had been cut in a lopsided manner, and it finally fell. So when it fell in 2012, I had gone to the AWOD BMC office at that time. And the officer at that time, I had requested them that you come and plant a new sapling in its place, preferably a large one, because it's a large green banyan tree. When we approached the officer told me that there was no plan to plant another tree in its place, that bed would be converted into a parking lot. So we were very disappointed because it was a huge amount of greenery that was suddenly gone, and a car would be parked in its place. But fortunately for us, they did not act on that threat. And by 2019, when I pointed out that a tree could be planted in the vacant spot, the BMC not only happily planted a tree, it also allowed us to choose which sapling we wanted and gave it to us free of cost, along with the gardening support. Not only that, on our road, the BMC this time actually created new tree beds between the existing tree beds, you know, giving us a lot of more greenery than we ever had before. So this was a most welcome change. And as I look back and I wonder what really caused this change, I have a feeling that it was the core of this change was the agitation of the people, which resulted in the government setting a 4-year target of planting 50 crore trees at the time. These targets were then devolved onto different departments, including the BMC by ward. And so our ward officers were keen to meet those targets and therefore very happy to plant the trees. And these citizens were very happy to have the trees on our road. So I want to just take a moment and thank this BMC team, because, you know, as citizens, we are on the road. We are the eyes and ears of the road, and we can see what happens to the green and we enjoy the trees. But the people empowered really to make a change and to plant these trees are the BMC officials. And that included our A-Ward corporator, Harshita Narvekar. She was so enthusiastic. She has come on a number of tree walks with us, on a number of sapling plantation initiatives. She's always available to us if we need her, including in instances of, you know, excessive trimming. Mr. Praveen Pardesi was the garden superintendent, you know, who we used to approach, who was also on our tree group. So all of these people were also on our tree group at one point or the other, or they still continue. Most of them still continue to be on that group. Mr. Shetty is the junior tree officer who I had shown a photograph of earlier, Mr. Tushar Shinde also, and Mr. Ashwin Jayale is also a tree officer whose photograph is in this presentation. All of these tree officers have been a source of great help in achieving all this greening on the road. Now, this is a view of our road as it stood. So we are moving now from one part, which is, you know, growing new trees and maintaining trees, to a second segment of this talk, which focuses on saving trees from being felled. So our road was like this. There was an ample amount of greenery on our road. And this is the year 2011. And like we just saw in Gauri's presentation, you know, we had a number of birds and butterflies. I just found out this is the sailor, I think, from Gauri's presentation. This is the coppersmith, a golden oriole, the quail, and we had a number of other birds on the road. But in 2012, we were shocked to find that, you know, the BMC plans to cut 150 trees on our road and take away all the greenery. The intention was to widen the road and accommodate more traffic. So this is a newspaper article, a headline article in Midday from the Time in 2012. Notices that, you know, there was a census of trees done by the BMC. These numbers were given. Notices were pasted on the trees. That is what they do before they cut the trees. And advertisements for cutting them were out in the press already, where people were asked to object to them. So I'm just going to lead you through the process briefly as to what happens when the trees in your locality are selected for felling. The procedure for controlling felling and trimming is laid out in what is called the Trees Act. It is the Maharashtra Urban Areas Protection and Preservation of Trees Act. And this act is easily available on the web, and it is a good idea for people to just get familiar with, you know, this Section 8, which talks about how, what is the process for felling a tree. And I have briefly described it over here. When to fell a tree, that applicant has to make an application to the BMC's tree authority. In this case, the applicant was the BMC itself, but they have to also apply to the tree authority to get the permission to fell the tree. The tree authority comprises the municipal commissioner and an equal, and should comprise an equal number of cooperators and NGO members. The tree authority then receives that application and sends a tree officer to investigate the case. And if the tree officer sees that the reasons to fell the tree are valid, he will affix a notice. This is the notice I was talking about on the tree. And he will put out an advertisement in the newspaper informing citizens that this tree is likely to get cut. And if the citizens wish to object, they have a small window of time in which they can do so. So then the citizens will object to the tree authority. All this process is laid down in the Trees Act. So when we heard about our trees getting cut on the Maharshi Kharve Road, we immediately put together a beautiful reason, well-reasoned note to the municipal authorities saying that we found out that if the intention was to accommodate more traffic on our road, that intention would not be served through the widening and felling of trees, because to the south of our road was a narrower bottleneck road, and that bottleneck could not be widened because it had buildings abutting both sides. So we came up to the BMC and with a well-reasoned note that that is put out. This is the note that we drafted. It's the top part of that note. We also provided many other alternatives. In all of these development projects, it is important not to be seen as hindering development, but to try to see if it can be done in a way that the trees are not going to be compromised. So we provided a number of other alternatives on how traffic could be managed in this note. And when we crafted this note, we actually studied the development plan of our area. This is the development plan extract of our area. We understood road alignment, and that understanding was reflected in the note, so that when it went to the additional municipal commissioner roads and the municipal commissioner, it was a well-reasoned note. It was something that they could appreciate. Then we objected to the tree authority, and this is our objection note that we finally wrote to the tree authority. It was a 34-page objection letter with 85 signatories from the road. And in this process of drafting different documents and, you know, putting together these notes, we got a lot of pro bono support at the time. A lot of free support came in our way because our intention was very pure. It was just that we wanted to save the trees. We didn't want to get into any other issues. Lawyers from the High Court came and helped us with correspondence. Media picked up our story on its own. Facilities were offered by local clubs to convene meetings of residents to work out the next step. And I must make a special mention that there were two officers in the World Wildlife Fund, which I had approached at the time, who carried out a gratis free census of the trees on our road because we wanted to catalog the trees so that, you know, if any was lost, we are able to show it to the BNC. So they came and spent hours together on this road with me and cataloged all of these trees at the time for us. So a lot of support came into us, and I was very grateful for that support. And so what we've done is we've created a page on Facebook called Save the Trees Maharshi Kharve Road, with this entire material of our correspondence with the BMC, of the correspondence of other buildings on our road with the BMC, of the objections note to the tree authority, is all put in over there so that if anybody else is in a similar situation, they can use it as reference material. The page again is called Save the Trees Maharshi Kharve Road. It's on Facebook. Everybody wasn't on Facebook, including the residents on our trees, on our street. So whenever we asked them, okay, this is the page, please come in and, you know, contribute, they would say we're not on Facebook. So we also created, I'm a chartered accountant, but my field is technology. So I, with my team, we've created a website called trees.firstlight.in. Goes under the name of Riksha Mitra. And where we showcased all the trees that were cut on a slider scale. So you can see all the trees that are in that look. And the localities map in question is also there. So it is shown on the bottom of the screen over here with a timeline which shows, you know, what is happening, and people are able to contribute to it. In addition, that website allowed you to actually speak about a specific tree, because, you know, amongst the 26 trees, some were very large, 70 feet and above, and had stood for 5 decades and over. So we wanted to showcase those trees, so you could actually track tree-wise details in this website. It also allowed you to, you know, put up a write-up on the species of the tree, which included, like, you know, you could write about the people, you could actually include, so people could be educated on the species in that particular locality. And this went locality by locality. And you could also summarize trees by different parameters, like trees which are tall, between 10 and 15 meter height of 10 and 15, and healthy or not healthy. This is all in meters, and the number of such trees by species and so forth. So this is available still online. Despite doing all of this, the tree authority finally, you know, first it started with 150 trees on our road and finally approved the felling of 26 trees. But some of these trees were very large, and we were very distraught at the thought of losing these trees. After they got the approval, however, because of our earnest efforts, perhaps, and I'm not sure what the reason was, but the BMC chief and the officers then decided to allow a compromise, and an agreement was reached in which our trees were all spared. So the agreement was that, you know, each building would give up 30 feet of their setback area, and some road widening was done, and between the trees, angular parkings were inserted. So they did some amount of road widening with angular parkings, and all 26 large trees were saved. And now it is 10 years from the date where we had this first debacle and the first campaign that I participated in to save these trees, and all those 26 large trees are standing tall, and we are quite thrilled that they've been with us all of these years. Since then, that website was used for other campaigns to save trees, including one for saving 3,000 trees at the Tungareshwar Tansa Road. It was also used to save 5,000 trees in the Save RA campaign. That website is still available for any other campaign across the city or elsewhere, where the people want to showcase the trees that are likely to get, that are in danger of being felled. And it is available free of cost for anybody who wants to, you know, save these trees. Now, over the years, through these trees campaigns and the neighborhood partnership with the government officers and citizens, I have come upon some interesting insights, which I'd like to share with all our prospective three warriors. The first is adversity seeks company. You know, when we were distraught and completely dismayed at the BMC notice to cut the trees on our road, that was the time when all the buildings on the road came together and we really got to know each other. Before that, we really never knew. We knew the buildings, but we never knew the citizens inside those buildings. But now, for the first time, residents met and we came to know each other and everybody contributed, you know, whatever they could to a common cause. Trees are a very binding force because everybody empathizes with trees. The second insight that I've got from all of these years, which I'd like to share with you all, is that trust builds with time. If your intention is sincere and only to save trees, then over time, the BMC officers that you will work with will all come to respect you. And the citizens on the road who are genuinely interested in saving trees, you will bond with. And they will all come to trust you and you will develop a rapport with all of them, which is in the next point, a lasting rapport between the core team members will form. And you will be always happy to meet with them, approach them. You will be able to, you feel that you can approach them easily. All those windows are open for you to talk to them. And you will work with them again and again and again through many such initiatives to bring in a positive change. The next one is that help pours in. You know, voluntary help pours in when you take up a cause for the trees. And that is a very heartening prospect. And I must add, you remember, I recall to you that I had requested two WWF officers to conduct a tree census for us, and they did it for they spent hours on our road and did it free of cost for us. And those two tree officers are now here on us on this call with us. And I must thank both Shreya and Gauri for having conducted that tree census for us at the time they were with WWF. Now they founded Oikos or Sense. So I'm very grateful to you all for having done that for us at the time. And this is my turn to repay the favor. Then the final insight that I'd like to share today is that, you know, a lot of people will empathize readily with trees and will speak for them, but only a handful will really do something to act for them. But one should not be deterred, because I've seen that little handful, maybe one person or maybe two people, sometimes four, that little handful of people is sufficient to turn the tide. In our case, for example, when we initially received the notices from BMC that our trees would be cut, we had 80 to 90 people on this road that would meet. But within a few days, that dwindled down to three or four people. But those three or four persisted right through the effort and were able to pool their resources. And, you know, the outcome was wonderful in this case. My final slide is this, where I'm going to talk about greening of a different kind. Now, in addition to greening your road, this is an initiative that we have tried in our society. We have put out feeders for parakeets and for sparrows. And the way these feeders are designed and the feed that is kept inside, in this case, this is a feeder for parakeets. And you can see peanuts with shells are placed inside. Now, peanuts with shells are going to be diet only for the parakeet, and the parakeet is an extremely acrobatic bird. So it can cling on, it can come upside down and things like that, which only it can do. So only it comes, the parakeets come to this particular feeder and take the feed from this feeder. So what happened was, we started this about 10, 12 years ago, where we put out bird feed for sparrows. Similarly, the sparrow feed is dana. We give them this dal dana and dalia. And the shelf is very small. So pigeons, which are the other contender for the feed, and the ledge is very small, and the roof on top is too low down below to allow a pigeon. So only the sparrows will really be able to get to the feed. And as a consequence, what has happened is that crows and pigeons, which used to infest our trees, and every summer or every breeding season, we'd have at least five or six crow nests on each tree. And the crow is a formidable, menacing bird. It drives away all the other birds from the region. Because we have a lot of parrots in the morning that come in and take this feed, 30 to 50 sometimes, the number of parakeets that turn up has dissuaded the crows from coming to these trees as much. They've stopped nesting on their own, and suddenly other birds have been able to come into the area, including here. You see, this is a rose-ringed parakeet. This is an Alexandrine, much bigger parakeet. And the hornbill, the gray hornbill, has started visiting these areas. So in conclusion, I just want to say that from our experience of trying to green one's own neighborhood, starting with the local areas and then working and reaching out to others, I'll say that teamwork is a key to try to, you know, achieve a greater amount of green in your locality. The teamwork between citizens and government officers can result in, you know, great benefits to a locality. One thing I'd like to add over here is that I, from my experience, found that when we were fighting to save trees in our area, some of the neighboring areas just did not resonate with our campaign to save trees. They just kept out of it completely. So that made me make a resolve that if there was ever an instance where I could help a neighboring area to save its trees, I would definitely try to do that. And I have done that, and you know, it has had great dividends. I want to just share with you to save, conclude and just summarize once again, to save trees from felling, because felling of trees is one of the biggest losses one faces in a greening campaign. One should be familiar with the Tree Act. One should look out for notices stuck by the BMC to the tree, which will announce that the tree will be felled. One should write an objection note to the tree authority, and a website is available and Facebook pages are available for assistance if it is needed to this end. The other thing one must try to prevent is excessive trimming of trees. Sometimes these contracts for trimming of trees are given to people who will sell the wood. So their interest lies in cutting too much of the wood away. So where you want to prevent excessive trimming of the trees, ask for permission on the site. So the tree officer has to be present on the site, and the BMC permission to trim trees has to be on the site, and that will notify the tree and the girth of the branch that is to be cut. And if you happen to have a WhatsApp forum with your local tree officer and your citizens, they will be great eyes and ears to prevent this over trimming, which is an annual exercise otherwise. To maintain trees and plant new saplings, do the same kind of partnership with the government officers of your ward in your region. You will have to cultivate that trust, and you will have to, you know, where you are generally fond of trees, it will build automatically over time. You don't need to do anything extra. You will identify citizens in your area who will act to save the trees, plus those who will just speak about saving the trees, because even their input is often valuable. Form a team, conduct tree walks, and plant saplings like we've done in vacant spots. And finally, encourage birds other than crows and pigeons in your neighborhood. In our example, for one or two of us started, but then more people have taken up feeding the birds of our area. So what happens is it is a distributed contribution. And basically, pigeons and crows really feed on crows definitely feed on the garbage that mankind creates as a byproduct to city living. So what has been our undoing on one side can be reversed out, is what we found, through some nice proactive doing, which is putting out feed specific to these birds. And these feeders can be easily bought online on sparrowshelter.in, for example. You can just look it up and let me know if I can help you in any manner in being able to save the trees in your area. So that brings me to the conclusion of this civic collaboration of working with government officers and citizens in order to save the local green. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Such a great work. I mean, you can see the chat box and many of the participant has written that, thank you, it's a great work, thank you for sharing, and sort of a, you know, very inspiring comments in the chat box. Thank you, Ruchir. Thank you for saying.
You can check the Neelam's question. Did you have to tackle with the concretization of the pavement affecting the tree life, which happens normally in Delhi?
Oh, yes. So what we've done in...
We are concretized.
Yeah, well, I think our concern was focused on trees. So what we tried to do was make sure where tree bed sizes were inadequate, the roots did not have space to breathe, Then we pointed it out to the tree officer. And in a number of cases where it was possible, the tree officers had asked their teams to widen the tree bed to allow the roots to breathe more freely. The pavements in our part are made with paver blocks mostly. They're not concrete, they're paver blocks.
So the question was raised to the tree officer itself.
Yeah, because we've got this partnership going, it's easy to, you know, have the tree officer alongside with you on the tree walk and point out to them what needs to be corrected.
Good. Also, another question is there from Mr. Arvin that, you know, metro work is going on in Dadar Shivaji Park area. So there is also a lot of cutting of trees is there. So how they can tackle with this question? So
So metro work gets us to the Save Trees campaign that we had also carried out. In 2015, I was engaged in trying to save the church gate trees on the J Tata Road. There was about 70 trees that were notified for cutting because of the metro works. So we formed a WhatsApp group, like I told you, and a lot of the serious people who were committed to doing something for the trees, 10 of them, I would say, came together initially and met. And then, we went a long distance trying to dissuade them from cutting the trees. What we found was to save the trees, they just needed to change the station design a little bit. In Fort, for example, their station was about 60 feet wide. In Churchgate and other places, their station boxes were much wider. These station boxes were sunk underground. We found that with a little engineering tweak, they could probably make narrower station boxes. If they made a narrower underground station box, then the trees on either end of the station box, which is where the trees are getting cut, 5,000 trees across the city were really divided into, at that time, 3,000 trees in the city and 2,000 trees in RA. So the 3,000 trees in the city were getting cut at 27 station locations because the station box had to be sunk into the road. Now, I might be getting too technical, but basically we said if you build a narrower station underground like you've done in other parts in Fort, then you can save the trees on either side. This matter went to court, and the people who got on in the initial core group of 10 people, they had approached the court. The court heard us out for an extended period. I think for 5 months they heard us. 4 months, so we had a stay on felling trees. But eventually the courts lifted the stay and allowed the metro works to proceed. And they gave us one respite that, you know, one of our team members, Zoru Bathena, was allowed to oversee the transplantation of trees. So how can you actually prevent it? Now, if you work with your tree authority, the local ones and the metro officers, you may be able to, because the court has given them a go ahead and they have the permissions to cut trees. If you work with them diligently, you may be able to identify a few trees like we did, which could be spared. For example, in our case in Churchgate, there was a tree that was a huge banyan tree that is at the circle that goes towards Cricket Club of India. That banyan tree, they were going to cut one night. At 11 o'clock in the night, I remember some of us had gathered around the tree to prevent it from being felled by showing them that the metro alignment on their plan was such that the tree did not interfere with it. So even though they had the approval, they should not cut it. And eventually we were able to save it.
Thank you so much. But Neelam has asked it again. There's this transplantation of trees. Did they survive properly? What was the survival rate?
Yeah. So what happens is the BMC officers we worked with for the metro project confided in us that on an ordinary transplantation, 10% is the survival rate, 90% die. But because we had team members appointed by the High Court of Mumbai to oversee the transplantation, it was done more thoroughly and we had a much higher transplantation rate. So if you were to look at the 3,000 number of trees in the city, if 1,500 were to get transplanted, and if this rate of survival was even 40%, then an additional 30% out of that 1,500, which is about 450 trees, survived.
That's a very good number, actually.
Yeah, so it was, you know, you take up each cause and whatever little success you get, you know, that itself is very satisfying, I would say. So I'd encourage people to take up green causes actively, at least in their own localities. if not the neighboring ones and broader ones.
So that is very important, I think. And what you can say, the hard work and the dedication which is required to follow up all these events, that is also a very important thing which you are doing right now. We have one more question for Gauri, actually. Gauri, are you there? Gauri?
To unmute, yeah, I was unmute.
Yeah. So there is one more question for you.
Yes.
What do you like to suggest to people to increase the, you know, the diversity which is there in the cities? To, if they want to increase the diversity, what majors you will like to suggest?
First of all, we have to save whatever we have. Other thing is, the life forms surrounding your area. That is one thing that you can definitely do. And of course, if you want to protect, yes, then Mr. Ruchir sir has already told you what is to be done. Yeah, so that's it. Even if you want, don't have any space, you can do it in on your terrace. You can do it.
Bird feeds specific to the birds,
right,
like that.
Right.
So these things will help. Yeah. Yes.
In our area, we had so many crows that it had come to a point that, you know, I would wonder how to get rid of these crows without hurting the bird. Is there was another way to do that? And feeding the parrots, and it happened on its own. It was delightful to, you know, just see that change in the ecology locally on its own, a very natural way. So it is something I'd certainly want to share with people. They should try to experiment if they've not already been veterans who've been doing this over the years.
Oh, that's a wonderful idea. Actually, yes, when other birds start coming in, definitely they try to adapt, and you will also see
So, is there any question? I don't see any questions now.
Okay.
Yeah. Richard, sir, you would like to say anything?
Well, I'd like to just thank everyone for this, and I'd be happy to be available for anyone who wants to, you know, save trees in their locality. If they'd like to discuss any ideas with me, I'm always going to be available for that.
Thank you so much. So, here,
and Gauri and Shreya, I'd like to thank you once again for you know, the work that you carried out 10 years back for us on the road. It was an important piece of, it was a very important contribution in our effort to save the trees.
Oh, that pleasure was completely ours, sir. Thank you so much for inviting us, actually. We wouldn't have come to know otherwise what all efforts are going at the citizens' level. So that was something really important. Thank you so much for this.
You're most welcome. So like Gauri and Shreya are also part of the WhatsApp group that we formed from 2017. So you will find, all of you all will find people who are committed to saving trees. Now, one thing I'd also just like to add at this moment is, it is wonderful that you have specific knowledge about trees, horticulture or zoology. That is always going to be an added advantage. But tree lovers can come from other non-related facets too. And some of our greatest activists here, for example, you know, I have worked with a number of them. They won't be able to tell you the difference between one tree and the other, the banyan and the people perhaps, but not much beyond that. Okay. So, but they will act a lot in many ways to save the trees, and their commitment and dedication to saving trees has been tremendous. So you will find people like Gauri, Shreya and other people from different walks of life who will be happy to take a step with you in saving trees, and it's wonderful to stay connected with these people.
Right. So as we keep on saying ki, to be a nature lover, you really don't have to, you know, come study like us or you know, stand like us and keep on saying ki, ye ped hai, wo ped hai. No, you can be of any educational background, you can be anything, but you can be a nature lover and you can save trees, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Very well said. Yes, Shreya?
Yeah. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for all the listeners over here. And as I said earlier, this was our last session for the Spectrum of Conservation web series on Zoom. And next, for the next level, we are going to announce a certificate course. Of course, it will be online only, but a certificate course. Let's see, it's still in a planning process. We are talking with the experts and, you know, how to finalize everything. So we will announce soon on our OicoEssence Facebook page or the Twitter page or on Insta page. We have your email, so we will inform you through email as well. So till that, you can stay tuned with our Facebook, Insta, Twitter pages. And whenever the course will be announced, join the course and study it. So thank you. Thank you, everybody, for this session.